Hi, I'm Norman Wildberger, and this is the first of a series of videos that's going to show you a much better and simpler and more elegant way of thinking about trigonometry. Trigonometry is a subject that confuses and baffles millions of students every year. From my point of view, there's a good reason. It's because the trigonometry that you currently learn in schools is the wrong trigonometry. It's overly complicated, it's inaccurate, and it's cumbersome. I'm going to show you a much better way of thinking about the subject called rational trigonometry, which is only a few years old. This talk today is going to show you why the classical trigonometry is in fact so hard. So we're going to overview the main stuff that you learn. Of course, trigonometry is the study of triangles, in particular the study of the measurement of triangles. And the way we measure triangles today is with a ruler and a protractor. So here is a particular triangle, and I've measured the three side lengths in inches, as it turns out, and I've measured the three vertices angles in degrees. There are three main laws that connect these six quantities. Every student has to learn them. The easiest one is that the sum of the angles is 180 degrees. If we measured angles in radians, then we would have to say the sum of the angles is pi. Here is the sine law and the cosine law. The sine law expresses a relationship between an angle and its opposite side. So the sine of 72 divided by 13.1 is the same as the sine of 60 degrees divided by 11.8, which is also the same as the sine of 48 degrees divided by 9.5. The cosine law allows us to calculate one side, say this one, 9.5, if we know the other two sides and the opposite angle. Both these functions involve sine and cosine, standard circular functions. Here's another formula from antiquity, usually called Herod's formula, although it was originally known by Archimedes. It expresses the area as a function of the three side lengths. And you can calculate that for this particular triangle, the area happens to be this. Okay, so that's not the whole story, of course, because in order to understand these laws more accurately, we first of all have to be clear about just what distance and angle actually are. And then we have to have a good look at what these circular trig functions are and how we get them. So let's do that. Modern treatments of geometry suppose that distance and angle are the fundamental quantities. That's not, in fact, so clear. If you go back to Euclid's Elements, we find that Euclid actually avoided distance, and there's no mention of angles, measurements, in his book. There's a good reason for that. Let's have a look why. Here are two points, A1 and A2, in a grid. So if the separation there is, say, 1, then we might ask, what's the distance between these two points? Well, it's not hard to give an expression, because we're going over 5 and up 2, and Pythagoras' theorem then allows us to deduce that the distance between A1 and A2 is the square root of 29. Now, unfortunately, that number is an irrational number, with a decimal expansion that begins like this, but goes on in a very mysterious way. Euclid was nervous about numbers like this, and that's why he avoided purposely talking about distances. Angles are even more problematic. Here's the standard definition of an angle in radians. We have two lines, here and here, and to measure their separation, we draw a circle centered at the point of intersection. Then, we define the angle theta to be the ratio of gamma over r, where gamma is that arc length, r is the radius of the circle. That, however, means that you have to have a theory of arc length before you can define angles. And as Archimedes realized, the notion of an arc length, even of a part of a circle, is quite problematic. It does really require calculus. So high school courses actually cheat when they talk about angles before calculus. However, there are other problems with angles too. Some of these problems concern units. Should we measure in radians, or in degrees, or in grads, as they do in Europe? What about orientation? Should we measure an angle from here to here? Or should we measure from here to here? Or perhaps from here to here? Or perhaps from here to here? And there are many other possibilities. There's some kind of ambiguity as to exactly what we're measuring. But the main problem with angles is that almost any problem involving angles ultimately cannot avoid the transcendental circular functions cosine, sine, and tan. It's just the way mathematics is. These functions are unavoidable, and they cause students a lot of pain because they're usually defined in a rather waffly way. Let's have a look at some of the problems with these functions. There are altogether six circular functions: sine, cosine, tan, cosecant, secant, and cotan. Students have to learn about all six of these functions and their graphs and various special formulas and relations between them. Here, for example, is the graph of perhaps the simplest of them, the sine function, which is a periodic function like this. And when we properly define it, it involves the numbers pi, 2 pi, and 3 pi, because we're measuring the angle theta in radians. So students have to learn exact detail about the shape of this graph and particular values. To calculate this function, actually an infinite series is required. Here is the infinite series expansion for sine theta discovered by Newton. There are also inverse functions to each of these six circular functions. Here's the inverse function to the sine function called arcsine, and it also has an infinite power series expansion, which turns out to be much more complicated than the one for sine. It was actually discovered by Indian mathematicians a couple hundred years before Newton. So on top of all these essentially formulas from calculus, if you want to understand circular functions correctly, there are dozens of relations that students have to learn. They learn that cos squared theta plus sine squared theta equals 1, that sine 2 theta equals 2 cos theta sine theta, that cos A plus B is cos A, cos B minus sine A, sine B, and dozens of other formulas. So it's a lot of work, and in fact, most books on trigonometry spend a majority of their time involved with these circular functions, rather than actually the triangles that are the heart of the subject. Because the situation is so complicated, students are incapable of answering questions precisely for the vast majority of triangles. They have to rely on their calculators to help them out. There are really only about two triangles that students actually can work everything out completely. That's the 90-45-45 triangle and the 90-60-30 triangle. If you're a student of trigonometry, you will see these things dozens, perhaps hundreds of times in your career, because these are the only two triangles, essentially, that students can actually work out everything by hand. That's pretty limiting, really. And it's a suggestion that there perhaps really is a better way around. Well, that better way is called rational trigonometry. And with rational trigonometry, we can study precisely hundreds of triangles, not just two. In my next video, I'm going to introduce the main idea of rational trigonometry and show you that it actually comes from the way the Greeks thought about geometry. I'm Norm Wildberger. Thanks for listening.